Very good morning, all of you. I am Dr. M.C. Nataraja, professor in the Department of Civil Engineering, Ramayya Institute of Technology, MSRIT, Bangalore. Friends, today I will be taking the next module, the module 5, which is in connection with the analysis and design of beams. Beams, as you know, is a flexural member. Welcome to session 1, and let us see as to what this session as far as the subject is concerned. In fact, the module 5 is the section on design of beams. What is that we will be discussing in this particular module? So this is what the content of the syllabus, which I have taken straight away from the syllabus. See the different terminologies that are connected with this module. Basically, it is the design of beams. Of course, some introduction to the topic, beams, types of beams, lateral stability of beams, factors affecting the lateral stability, behavior of beams in bending, design strength of laterally supported beam in bending, design of laterally unsupported beams. And kindly see, we need to study all the fundamental things as far as the behavior of the laterally unsupported beam, but numerical problems only not included as a part of the examination. Shear strength of steel beams is another thing we need to look at. And finally, we have a few connections, beam to beam connections, beam to column connections, and column splices. And of course, no numerical problems in the examination. So this is what the content of the module 5. So this is what I have presented in one of the earlier classes also. We have different types of rolled sections being used in the steel structure construction. And this is one of the most common section. So Indian standard I section, though we have different classifications. We have the junior beams, lightweight beams, medium beams, heavy beams, wide flange beams, so on and so forth. Kindly see, this is what I have taken from the Google source. And this is where the parallel flange section comes into picture, and these are all some of the parallel flange sections being used today. And this is the conventional non-parallel flange sections or the tapered flange section. And as I mentioned in one of the earlier classes, so these I sections are symmetric sections, and as far as their bending resistance is concerned, so the beams behave very strongly with respect to the horizontal axis passing through the centroid. And that horizontal axis passing through the centroid is referred to as the major principal axis, about which the second moment of area is absolute maximum. And also we have the minor principal axis, happens to be the other symmetric axis, again passing through the centroid, and about which the second moment of area is absolute minimum. So that is the reason, with respect to horizontal XX axis, the beam is having a maximum resistance to the bending. I is maximum, and of course for a given E, EI is maximum, and that is what the parameter governs the behavior of beams in flexure. So keeping this thing in mind, so let us say what these beams are. Beams have a far more complex load carrying action than the other structural elements such as trusses and cables. So basically the beams are flexural members subjected to transverse load, where the load is pushing the beam in such a way that it bends in the vertical plane. So there is no movement of the beam happening in the lateral direction. So that is where the beams are subjected to vertical loads, and these loads are referred to as the transverse loads. And because of the transverse load, the beam undergo bending. Obviously, along the span of the beam, we have the variation of the bending moment. And of course, we also have the variation of the shear force, and we also have the deflection, and the deflection is generally maximum somewhere near the center of the beam. And it also depends on what type of loading and the loading combinations and the nature of the loading. So whatever is the situation, so as a part of the analysis and design, we need to identify those locations where the bending moment is maximum, for which you need to design the beam for the moment effect. We also need to identify where the shear force is maximum, for which the section is to be checked for the shear resistance. And also we need to ensure that the deflection at the center of the beam is not exceeding the allowable deflection. So we need to satisfy the limit state of strength as a part of bending moment and as a part of shear force. That is where the collapse limit states comes into picture. And of course we need to check the performance of the beam with respect to deflection. That is where the limit state of serviceability comes into picture. So we also have other types of limit states and with respect to the strength and also with respect to the serviceability. Depending on the situation, many of those special limit states are needed to be addressed. So whatever is the situation, my dear friends, let us see what really happens in a beam from the point of its behavior. Now, once you identify the section where the bending moment is absolute maximum, and that is the section where we have the plastic moment or even the elastic moment depending on the situation, and we need to identify what is the distribution of the bending stress across the section. So depending on the nature of the beam, whether it is in the working condition or whether it is in the plastic condition. And also you know the variation of the shear force. Generally at support section, the shear force is maximum. The variation of the shear force, as you know, it is parabolic across the cross section. And that is what the situation we have seen in rectangle or cross sections. And here many of the sections are having some sort of a thin elements, combinations of flanges and web. So where the variation is parabolic only, but a small variation do happen because of a sudden change in the width of the element. So flange widths getting reduced to the web thickness. So that is the location where we have a sudden rise in the stress coming into picture. So many of these things and also the exact distribution of the shear stress we'll be discussing in greater details. And these are all the three things we'll be addressing as a part of the limit state design. So before that, we need to analyze the beam as a whole for the variation of the bending moment, shear force, and of course for the type of the deflection. So we have different types of beams. So as you know, based on the support, the beams can be classified as a simply supported beam, cantilever beam, fixed beam. Fixed beams are also referred to as the encastered beams. And of course, we have the continuous beams also. In fact, in the module 1, in the plastic method of analysis, we have seen. So what are all the advantages of the fixed beam compared to simply supported beam? So obviously, fixed beams carries more load compared to simply supported beam, mainly because of the redistribution of the bending that really happens. And continuous beam, of course, it is indeterminate in nature, and definitely many of the advantages of the fixed beam we'll be able to explore in this continuous beam. And if you see a multi-story structure made of steel, so generally you'll be having a framed structure. And if you see any one of the frame, one way continuous frame, either in the horizontal direction, so one way continuous frame in the vertical direction, it is a multi-story, multi-bay type of framing system. Take any one intermediate frame, obviously we have the columns, and of course connecting the columns, we have the beam. And many of these columns and beams are generally constructed out of steel I-sections. And of course different types of I-sections are used depending on the requirement. So that is where the width, depth, and the moment of inertia about the major axis, and also the combined moment of inertia about the horizontal major axis and the vertical major axis also needed to be addressed. In fact, if you see the classification based on the materials, so steel beams, that's what we are discussing here in this module. So concrete beams we might have studied in our RCC, RCC1. And of course, we have the beam made of pre-stressed concrete, timber beams. And of course, today we have the composite beams also. So the combination of steel and concrete is generally addressed. And also, as I mentioned, so in the first module, when I was discussing about the different types of structural sections, so what sections are generally used for beams and columns, and of course, there are many other applications of other sections. Now, as far as the flexural members are concerned, so we have the I section, we have the channel section, T section, angle section, equal angle or unequal angle. So T section and angle sections are extensively used in multi-story buildings, industrial buildings, which are generally constructed in such a way that it consists of many such elements looking in the form of T, L, and very rarely we use channel and I sections in such type of industrial buildings. And of course, we can also use circular rods, tubes, and built-up sections or plated sections also as a part of beam as far as the multi-story structures are concerned. And we have yet another classification of the beam which is quite interesting. That is what the student need to explore in this particular subject. So that is where in the module we have seen only the laterally supported beams are concerned and laterally unsupported beams. We need to study from the point of behavior and many factors that are influencing the behavior, but only the numerical problems need not be tackled as a part of this particular subject. But when you go to the next semester or the higher semesters, yes, we need to explore the importance of laterally unsupported beams also. So this is where so a lot of understanding from the point of behavior comes into picture. So that is where these beams are referred to as laterally supported and laterally unsupported. Now let us see in a simple diagram. So this is where the simply supported beam comes into picture, and kindly see the different axes. The horizontal axis ZZ, which passes through the centroid, which is the major principal axis, major symmetric axis, about which the second moment of area, the moment of inertia, is maximum. So definitely it offers maximum resistance as far as the bending behavior is concerned. And in fact, in this particular problem, we are trying to utilize the EI, which is there with respect to horizontal axis, EIZ, the flexural rigidity with respect to the major axis. And also you see the vertical axis passing through the centroid. So that is where the another symmetric axis, being the minor principal axis, comes into picture. My dear friends, kindly say, what is the axis Z, which is the axis that passes through the centroid but along the length of the beam? And this axis is referred to as the longitudinal centroidal axis. Now kindly see the load where I have applied. The load is exactly passing through the centroid. In fact, I have not shown the load on the cross section. So definitely the load is passing through the centroidal axis. And by chance, if I shift the load either to the left or to the right, the beam is subjected to some sort of asymmetric bending. Now the load is passing through the centroidal axis. The beam undergoes a very simple bending. But if you see the plane of the bending, that's very important, which I have shown here. The plane of the bending is XY. What is the meaning of this plane of the bending? So if you increase the load from, say, minimum value going up to some maximum, and of course up to W, which is the maximum load carrying capacity, where the entire cross section is getting plastified. In fact, this is what we have considered in the plastic method of analysis and design. So right from the first increment of the load till the beam fails, and if you see the bending profile, the entire bending profile, the entire curvature is confined in one plane. So that is what the plane X, Y is concerned. So even after the bending, the entire beam, the longitudinal centroidal axis, lies only in this X, Y plane. So that is where the plane of bending being vertical, and as long as the beam fails, so that plane of bending is confined to XY plane. So this is what is the behavior of a laterally supported beam. At this point itself, we'll make a mention, by chance at the time of bending, and maybe in the initial stages of the loading, the beam bends as if it is laterally supported, where the plane of the bending is confined to XY plane. But after you apply certain amount of load, and for the subsequent application of the load, the beam, especially the compression part of the beam, tends to move in the lateral direction. So this is where the instability of the beam comes into picture, and this is what the stage we need to identify, and that is the stage where the bending resist of the beam gets reduced and the buckling of the compression part takes place in the lateral direction. So this is where the behavior of a laterally unsupported element, or the behavior of a laterally restrained beam, comes into picture, and there are many factors that need to be looked at, and that is an entirely different concept. So let us not worry much about the behavior of laterally unsupported beam at this juncture. So what we are trying to discuss at this stage is the behavior of a simple beam where the plane of bending is confined to XY plane, where there is no lateral effect, the whole beam is laterally supported. So, and I will give you many examples as to how the beam can be made to behave in the laterally supported manner. Now, these are all the typical cross sections of the beam. In fact, this entire picture I have taken from the Google, and this is also available in textbooks by Dugal, textbook by Subramaniam, and as a reading material I am taking the advantage of showcasing some of these sketches. Now kindly see the different sections. So solid sections, so being the circular section, it is not a hollow section. You can also use hollow sections depending on the situation. Channel section, I section, and of course fabricated I section also you can see here, and how it really looks like. And this is where the closed section fabricated separately in the form of a thin walled box section, and this is what the compound section is. And these two are referred to as kindly see, they appear as if they are the composite beam, but strictly speaking, if you take the behavior of the individual I section as a beam, it is laterally supported. So what is the meaning of laterally supported? I will just try to explain few points here itself, because here the beam as a whole is confined inside the concrete. When the concrete beam bends, in the same way the steel beam which is embedded in the concrete also bends. So no portion of the I section is going to bend in the lateral direction because it is completely confined with the concrete. So it is not a free beam as you have in this case where it is externally free. In such situation, probably the beam may undergo bending in the lateral direction. Such type of thing is really not happening as far as this encased beam is concerned. Obviously, the steel beam which is encased inside the concrete beam, so it is laterally supported or laterally restrained. But even this particular beam, if you see, so where you have this slab resting over the beam, and kindly see at the junction where the flange is connected to series of struts along the span, where this entire struts is going into the concrete at the time of placing the concrete, thereby this slab is completely resting on the compression flange of the I section. So when the beam bends because of the slab as a whole pushing the beam, beam do bend, but the compression part is really not able to move in the lateral direction. It is mainly because of enormous of frictional resistance existing between the interface, and also you have the struts connected to the flange and embedded in the concrete all along the length of the beam, and which offers sufficient lateral resistance, sufficient resistance to the shear deformation that takes place in the horizontal direction. And hence, any part of the beam in the compression, as far as the steel part is concerned, it is really not going to bend in the lateral direction. So the lateral buckling is totally prevented. So this is where the behavior of a laterally unsupported beam comes into picture. Again, some more information with respect to this, with a few more diagrams, I'll be explaining in the subsequent slides. Now kindly see this particular section, what is the importance? Now if you see this section, in this section we have put an additional channel section, so that what is the moment of inertia about the horizontal axis now? The moment of inertia about the horizontal axis of the entire cross section, now it gets pushed to the top towards the compression part because we have kept additional area. And also see the contribution of the channel onto the horizontal moment of inertia. So the channel itself is having some moment of inertia about its of course it is a weaker axis, and that moment of inertia, as you know, need to be transformed, is to be transferred to the centroidal axis. So thereby substantial amount of the area gets transferred onto the main axis. So thereby the moment of inertia of this compound section with respect to the horizontal axis is quite large, and at the same time Kindly see the other advantage what you have. As far as the I section is concerned, the moment of inertia about the y axis is rather least. But because of the presence of the channel section, kindly see the way you have put the channel section, and about the weak axis of the I section, if you extend it, the major axis of the channel. So this is the major axis of the channel. The major axis of the channel goes through the minor axis of the I section. And also the fact is that we have put the channel in the compression side. So the moment of inertia of the compression part, which is called as the head part as far as this particular cross section is concerned, is getting increased substantially, that too with respect to the y axis of the entire cross section. So these are all the type of sections we need to look for gantry girder. So this is what the topic we discuss in the next semester under analysis and design of crane gantry girder, where the beam is subjected to biaxial bending with respect to the major axis. But of course, we also have the bending in the lateral direction, horizontal direction. To resist that bending, we need to increase the moment of inertia of the I section with respect to y. So that is possible only by putting some plates at the top, or maybe putting a channel in this fashion. So this is how we will be able to build suction, wherein the required amount of moments of inertia with respect to both the orthogonal axis, so depending on the magnitude of the bending with respect to major and minor axis, can be addressed. And also, if you see, so this particular element, so which is a box type of a section, and of course it is a thin walled section, it can be even a conventional plates what you will be using in the regular situation. So where the moment of inertia, if you see, of this combined section being the closed section, so along the horizontal axis, it is quite substantial. In fact, it is many times more compared to the I section, depending on the dimensions of the relative dimensions of flanges and web. And another important thing as far as this box section is concerned, the moment of inertia with respect to the y axis passing through the centroid. Kindly see that information about the y axis of the left part, which is again behaving like a small I section, though you have the lesser moment of inertia with respect to yy, that need to be transferred onto the centroidal axis, where yy passing through the centroid comes into picture. That is where the area of the entire left part into the distance square comes into picture, and like that we have the area onto the other side also. When you take both the areas in the y direction and transferring that effect onto the yy axis passing through the centroid, again we have a substantial amount of moment of inertia with respect to y axis, and that moment of inertia with respect to y axis can be further increased by putting the vertical plates still apart. And this is how we'll be playing with the configuration of the built up sections, box sections, in such a way that the section as a whole is equally strong, not only with respect to horizontal axis, even with respect to vertical axis. So this is where the importance of polar moment of inertia, combined orthogonal moments of inertia comes into picture. Resistance to biaxial moment, plus torsion, where the torsional rigidity comes into picture. So Gj being the torsional rigidity, my dear friends, as you know, so G is the shear modulus, but J, polar moment of inertia, and that polar moment of inertia, as you know, it is the summation of the rectangular moments of inertia, Iz plus Iy. But in I section, Iz is substantially higher, Iy is very, very small. But when you add it, a small increase in moment of inertia happens, but it's not going to increase the value tremendously. But when you have a configuration something like this, the moment of inertia will be quite large, not only with respect to horizontal, even with respect to vertical. And these are all the type of sections we need to select, especially when you have a situation of large bending moment with respect to horizontal, vertical, and of course whenever you have the presence of torsion. So this is where the importance of the different types of sections from the point of its behavior comes into picture. Now I have introduced a special category of beam. So in fact, we will be studying more about these beams in the advanced design of steel structure, and definitely in masters. So you will be studying many such special structures, analysis, design and things like that. So this is where getting a beneficial effect of a single eye section comes into picture. And kindly see, the eye section is split into two parts. If you split the eye section horizontally into two parts, we are not going to get any benefit. Again, you need to connect it, but that's not the efficient way of cutting. But if you cut it in this particular fashion and lift one and turn it by 180 degree and bring it back and make a connection, so it will be something like this. So this is how the concept of a tapered section will be able to get it. So in fact, if the configuration of the beam which suits the variation of the bending moment, and that is what the best configuration. And also if you have seen the variation of the bending moment, so in case of a simply supported beam subjected to a central concentrated load, the variation of the bending moment is triangular, almost zero, negligible moment near the support, and you have the maximum bending moment at the point where you have the concentrated load. In such situations, so many of these configurations are very, very effective. Especially in case of portal frame, so there are many instances that instead of going for a prismatic type of cross section, where the cross section is more or less uniform over the height, it is rather better to suggest such type of configuration, not necessarily made from a rolled section. It can be even fabricated separately, and if that is being used over the height of the column or even as a beam, depending on how the bending moment is varying over the height and the span of the portal frame, the configuration is very, very efficient, and of course lot of money will be able to save it. So this is where special configuration comes into picture. And also we have another special way of cutting it. Instead of cutting it straight at some inclination like this and then reversing it, so you can also cut it in a sort of zigzag manner, as we can see here. So cut it somewhere at the bottom just above the flange and cut it further and then cut it horizontally, and you have the profile something looking like this. And if this is what the situation, we have separated the eye section into two part. Now keep the bottom part intact, lift the top part, and then offset the top part by some distance equal to one crest width or one panel width, and thereby you are going to get some configuration of this type. So just try to get a feel of what this particular type of cutting and the concept of getting the enlarged depth. But here the figure is not drawn properly. So when you lift it and offset it, the depth of the castellated beam, so these are all the openings, castellos. So this is where the castellated beam comes into picture. So depth of the castellated beam will be substantially more compared to the depth of the original beam. So this is where the increased depth of the eye section comes into picture, and this is where the concept of increasing the depth by 25%, 50%, sometimes by 100 to 125% is also possible by introducing some sort of additional plates here. So you lift it further, and for the connection you please keep a incremental plate. With this, instead of getting a series of hexagonal openings, we are going to get series of octagonal openings. So this is where the importance of castellated beam comes into picture. Friends, I request you to just wait for a second. Yeah, very sorry for the disturbance that happened. So this is where the importance of castellated beam comes into picture, where the moment of inertia of the section over the horizontal axis can be increased tremendously, and the resistance of the beam can also be increased. And I have given a few photos, my dear friends, as you can see here. So the photo of the multi-story structure. So kindly see what this particular structure is. We have only two types of sections. All the vertical sections are eye sections. All the horizontal elements are the sections, beam sections. So again, they are the eye sections. So only I sections are being used to form the entire multi-story structure. The same I section we'll be seeing in the other photo also, but lot of internal openings are introduced. So in fact, the manufacturing technique itself is such that the holes are being introduced at the time of manufacturing rather than creating a holes of this type from the original I section. So that's what the concept in the earlier days used to be. So but now here it is always be possible to manufacture the castellated section depending on what type of configurations of the opening you need to have, and of course what is the depth you need from the point of design requirements. So the idea is only to showcase how aesthetically your building looks like. No concrete is involved, and of course the structure from many points of view, it is going to be advantageous, and many of these things we have discussed in the module 1. Now let us see another interesting structure, which is the industrial building. And in this industrial building we have many types of the road sections being used. In fact, we must have heard of rafter. So principal rafter, primary rafter, secondary rafter. So the rafter itself is a flexural member, but the type of sections required is very small. Sometimes we'll be using the T sections, sometimes rod sections, channel, small channel section can also be used. Z sections we'll be using for the rafter depending on the situation. And also you have a purling. What is this purling? So over the rafter, so you will be running elements. Kindly see these elements being run all along the entire length of the building. So that is what the purling, roof purling. And you have a series of roof purling, so kept over this portal frame, and on that you will be putting the roofing element. So maybe a galvanized iron sheet or any type of special sheets depending on the situation. So it may be a conventional multi-industrial building where hot rolled sections are being used, and we also have a concept of cold form sections, which I'll be explaining in one of the later classes, where the thickness of the element is very very small, and all these sections are fabricated from the sheets, not that it is manufactured from the ingot by a rolling operation. So these are all the rolled sections. So they are all the sections with substantial thickness. The length of the element to the thickness is substantial, and as a result of that, local buckling is not going to happen many a times. 90% of the situation, the local buckling is avoided in case of conventional I sections. That is how the width of the flange, the projecting part of the flange, and the depth of the web is being defined. I want to have the cross section to behave like a plastic section. In fact, you have seen as to what is this plastic section, what is this compact section, and especially the semi-compact section and slender sections are not recommended in case of plastic analysis and plastic design. But in case of cold form light gauge sections, the thickness is so small that all elements of the cold form section will undergo local buckling. The question of plastification doesn't arise. The failure is always be by buckling. So that is what just I wanted to bring in at this stage. What is this cold form section concept compared to hot rolled section concept? But this is the industrial building constructed out of either the hot rolled elements or the cold formed elements. And also kindly see, so we have even different elements. So grit, kindly see here, the grit is also sometimes subjected to biaxial bending. We need to cover this space between the series of grids by putting some cladding. The entire weight of the cladding get transferred to the grid rail. It's also called as the rail because it is running over a series of portal, and again it is subjected to sometimes the effect of wind. So it is subjected to combinations of bending, vertical bending and horizontal bending. The moment you say it is subjected to bending, so it is a flexural member. So it may be a flexural member with one plane bending or two plane bending, and sometimes bending with torsion. So many, many such combinations do come into picture, and accordingly we need to tackle the analysis and design. So what I want to tell you is all types of road sections, what I showed in the previous slides, all these sections can be used as a flexural member. And also you see here some of the braces. even sometimes the braces will be subjected to flexural effect. It might have been designed for the compression effect and of course the tension effect depending on the alternative effect of the axial forces, but sometime you also need to design the bracing for the bending action depending on the situation. So this is just to tell you so what different types of flexural members and what types of the sections will be able to select. And again, one more piece of information as far as these types of sections are concerned and how these sections are being used, the probable applications. The angle centers can be used for spans ranging from 3 meter to 6 meter, and especially for the light loaded beams such as roofs, purlins and sheeting rails. Only to explain this particular thing, how the angle centers are being used for a span of 3 to 6 meter, I have taken the example of this industrial building. So more than 50% of the elements go in the name of purlins and sheeting rails as far as an industrial building is concerned. And as far as the multi-story building is concerned, so we'll be using different types of road section where the span can vary from as small as 1 meter going up to 30 meters. So this is what the section generally used in multi-story buildings. Castellated beams, as I mentioned in one of the previous slides, again the span can vary from 6 meter up to 60 meter. Kindly see the road section up to 30 meter, but here the span is almost increased to 60 meter. The bending moment is almost becoming double. So WL square by 8, where span L square. So obviously the moment carrying capacity increases substantially. And that is what we are going to get in castellated beam by cutting the beam and increasing the depth of the beam by 25%, 50%, 100%. The moment of inertia increases by 200 to 300% and sometimes even beyond that. So that is where the efficiency of the castellated beam comes into picture. And of course, the cross section of the box cutter also we have seen in the earlier slides, where we'll be using different types of channels and eye sections to form the box. And individually also you'll be able to get the box sections directly from the manufacturer. The span varies from 15 meter going up to 200 meters. So where do you have such a long span, especially in case of bridges, deck slab, depth girders, bridge girders, especially for roads and railways. So these are all the types of girders. And some of the photos also I have shown in the first module, the importances of steel structures and how these steel structures are being used over small spans, medium spans and over long spans. So that also has been discussed and I have showcased few photographs also taken from the internet. Now friends, so let us go to the importance of the behavior of the flexural member. So before we understand the actual behavior of the eye sections and such type of road sections, let us see in a simple way, what is this local buckling? So these are all the sections called as slender sections, neither the compact or plastic, maybe sometimes semi-compact and more likely in the direction of slender section. Now kindly see the flange, the outstand of the flange, the thickness of the element is small compared to the length, and when you start applying the load, so there is every possibility that the flange, the top flange buckles in this fashion. So we get a series of buckling waves. So each of these waves is confined to a small panel. So that is where defining a panel between successive waves of the buckling comes into picture. And whatever the type of buckling that is happening at the top, a similar type is happening at the bottom. Probably this is the element subjected to a concentrated compressive force as a column. The idea is to showcase what the local buckling is all about. A similar type of local buckling, you are going to get it in the box section. Kindly see here, box section is a closed section, whereas eye section is an open section. In case of open section, the torsional resistance is not that good. And also the moment of inertia with respect to weak axis is very less. But here, all the elements are kept at some constant distance away from the centroid. So obviously we have the two vertical axis contributing to IZ and two horizontal axis, two vertical axis contributing to other orthogonal axis. So two vertical elements for the horizontal I, and two horizontal elements for the I with respect to the vertical axis. So Iz, Iy, and even Izz plus Iyy. So they're all large, but still at the time of failure, it is not going to fail by yielding. So that's what you need to appreciate. Now kindly see the buckling wave. So more or less the similar type of buckling wave comes into picture. So the buckling wave is making the small portion of the element to buckle outwards, and then the inward buckling of the plate, outward buckling of the plate, like that it happens all along the length, at the top, at the bottom, and even at the sides also. So this is one of the important characteristics of the section, where the width of the section compared to its thickness or width to thickness ratio is very small. For a given thickness, the width is substantially longer. So there is a tendency of element undergoing buckling in its own plane. And this is one of the important property of the cold form light gauge section, which I discussed just few minutes ago. And this is what is referred to as local buckling. Local buckling is a rule rather than exception. Means all light gauge sections do undergo local buckling. Plastification of the cross section is not going to happen, and plastic method of analysis cannot be extended to such type of cold form light gauge sections. This is another interesting thing, whether it is a light gauge section or even a hot roll section. So if you have a closed section, so the strength of the element is definitely stronger from the point of flexure, from the point of bending. And this is where the importance of K comes into picture, which we'll be able to see in the buckling stress formula in the next slide. So one particular panel, what I have shown here, kindly see this particular panel. What is the load that really makes one panel something like this to buckle? So that is generally 8 times of the load that is required to cause a similar type of buckling wave to form in an open section like this. So that is the reason open section is more susceptible to local buckling, where the strength is less. But a similar type of section, if you make it in this fashion, where all elements are closed and you need to apply enormous load, not just 2 times or 3 times. In fact, if you go by the concept, so this particular configuration is 8 times stronger. I request the students to go through some of the good textbooks on design of steel structure, where many of these things are being discussed. And kindly see the design of plate elements. So whether it is a cold form section or even a hot roll section, so we need to see that the element is having certain minimum thickness outstand of the flange to the thickness. It should not be more. If it is more, it buckles. And if it is buckling at a lower stress, the question of the element undergoing plastification doesn't come into picture. Each and every element of the I section, any roll section for that matter, has to undergo plastification. The entire cross section has to yield. Web is yielding, but flange is not yielding. Or flange is yielding, but the web is undergoing premature buckling. So the plastification is not going to happen, and you will not be able to realize the MP. And obviously, the limit state of collapse is not applicable, because the strength is not gone by the plastic capacity. So that is where the limitation of the thickness to the width, or sorry, width to the thickness plays a very important role. So based on this only, the classification of the section has been done, and this is also what we have discussed in the module 1. So section classification and what IS 800 says as far as these things are concerned. Now kindly say another situation where the buckling of the beam is happening. So the beam bends. So obviously when the beam bends, so you know, to one side there is a compression, onto the other side there is tension, and wherever you have the compression, so that particular flange will undergo local buckling. So this local buckling is considered separately in a working stress method. So we have the IS 800 1984. So where local buckling is avoided by specifying the BYT limits explicitly, and this local buckling is considered, is not considered explicitly in local buckling, but otherwise this is already considered in the design in the limit state method, because That is how the section itself is being classified, depending on the ratio of B to thickness. So that is where the semi-compact and slender section comes into picture. And some adjustment to the moment carrying capacity by way of factors is being defined in the limit state method. Now, these are all the things I have already discussed in the module 1 in plastic method of analysis. And those students who have exposed to all the modules systematically, so it is really a sort of repetition for them. But any student is hearing to the lecture for the first time, maybe some explanation is required for him. And keeping that in mind, I take about 5 to 10 minutes to complete what these sectional elements and how the classification of the elements has been done in IS 800. So this is where the open sections comes into picture. All these things are open sections. So they are all the elements, and kindly see how the width to thickness ratio of the element is being defined. So we need to do these types of check in the design of beam also. So that is the reason I'm explaining. So kindly see the vertical element. The overall depth of the T section is being regarded as the B. In case of angle, the entire depth of the angle, entire width of the angle. If the angle is 100 by 100 by 10, so the entire depth of 100, entire width of 100 is treated as B. And of course, we have the thickness. So like that, we need to define what is B by T. So when you have an I section, what is B? So kindly see from where the B is being defined. So from the center, where that center is passing through the centroidal axis. So it is not the outstand. So it is the center distance measured from the mid point of the flange. So like that in case of channel. And of course, if you have a plated section, built up section, and how to define B, and of course the corresponding thickness, so that what is B by T of the element. Because we have connected the element, so see the top plate element with the flange by means of a series of bolts all along the span. So the question of the entire outstand bending doesn't come into picture. It is only the projecting part beyond the connection might undergo local buckling. So that is where B by TF of the outstand beyond the connection. In this case, it may be the bolt or the rivet. So that need to be considered. Or similarly, so in case of closed section, so how to define? So these things are straight away taken from IS 800, and I request students to look into IS 800. So whenever they want to do any type of analysis with those types of sections. So this is also the information I have discussed in the module 1 in plastic analysis. And in beam, so we want our section, I section or any sections we are using as a plate element. So we want that section to be plastic, where the entire depth of the cross section is plastified. And also the section is such that it has to undergo continuous rotation. So that is where the hinge undergoing continuous rotation comes into picture. But here, not much of a difference as far as the moment carrying capacity is concerned. Still, it resists EMP, but the portion of the beam is not able to undergo continuous deformation or the continuous rotation. So that is where the onset of yielding and further deformation giving some sort of a warning. So where we define the safety in plastic analysis will not be there as far as compact section is concerned. So semi-compact and slender, if you see the variation of the distribution of the stress across the depth, it is partially plastic from the extreme top and extreme bottom. And of course, if you see the center, it is more of elastic in nature. So that is where the elastic plastic distribution of the stress comes into picture. But if you have a slender member, the stress distribution across the cross section is completely elastic in nature, and the extreme fiber stress is substantially less than the yield stress. This is what the distribution of the stress across the cross section depending on the moment to which it is subjected. Now kindly see the moment here. So we are subjecting the slender element in the form of a beam to a moment which is substantially less than My. So the section undergo failure at this particular moment, undergoing a maximum deformation of 5Y. But kindly see here, in the second one, so you can increase the moment further, means load on the beam can be increased further and it goes up to My, but still the resistance of the section is not completely reached, it is only yield stress, but in that particular section. But if you increase it further, you go beyond My, so that is where partially yielding of the extreme fibers and still some elastic resistance near the core is having. That is where the moment carrying capacity of the semi-compact section is more than that of the yield capacity, but less than the so-called the maximum capacity, which is the plastic capacity of the section. So the moment carrying capacity can be further increased, and of course at this it fails with bit of rotation, may not be substantial, but in the plastic category the deformation is quite continuous. So many of these things I have discussed in the module 1. It is a repetition, and classification of the section also I have presented it. So you need to check whether the I section considered for the beam design is plastic or compact, based on whether it is a rolled section or a welded section. And this is what the consideration for the outstand. So this is the flange of the I section. Please remember 9.4 epsilon, 100.5 epsilon and 15.7 epsilon. So this is what the number you need to look for as far as flange is concerned, and as far as the web is concerned, where the neutral axis lies at the mid depth. Most of the problem in the examination is of this type, especially for the slow learners. I am making a request, if you cannot explore the entire table, please remember some of these values as per the flange is concerned, these sets of values, as per the web is concerned, these sets of values. And as long as the width to thickness is less than 9.4 epsilon, in fact I have told you as to what this epsilon is, because this epsilon is a non-dimensional parameter, so corresponding to 250 megapascal steel, so it is taken as 1. Otherwise we have a formula, so where the value can be either more or less depending on the value of the yield stress. Even if you take the yield stress as 250, so all these epsilon values will be 1, and if the depth of the web to its thickness, if it is less than 84 times, then it is plastic. The web undergo full plastification. If the width of the outstand to thickness of the flange is less than 9.4, even the flange also undergo plastification. The entire cross section undergo plastification, and the section is able to develop MP, the plastic moment capacity. But still it undergoes continuous rotation. That is where the rotation of the plastic hinge comes into picture. Here, the width is somewhat more here. The depth of the web is more somewhat here. But it reaches the plastic moment, but it is not able to undergo continuous deformation. By chance, if you try to apply additional load, rather than the hinge undergoing rotation, the section itself will fail by buckling, where we will not be able to see the rotation of the hinge. So similarly, in case of a semi-compact section, so here the section is not able to resist MP, but still a substantial moment, more than the yield moment, comes into picture. So there is a reason, increasing the width of the flange, outstand of the flange, the moment carrying capacity keep on decreases. Similarly, as the depth of the web is increased, the moment carrying capacity keep on decreases. So this is where, especially when you are discussing with the behavior of a deep beam, especially the girders, plate girder is one important structural member you will be analyzing and designing as a part of the next semester subject. So we have to be careful about the behavior of such type of elements from the point of buckling. So friends, I will stop at this stage. So as far as the first session of the module 5 is concerned, so let us see how exactly the beam behaves when it is laterally restrained, and how the stress distribution across the cross section takes place, and how to address the moment, shear, the deflection from the point of analysis and design. We'll be continuing in the next class. So thank you very much, my dear friends. So if you have any questions, so you can ask.